We are live.
Okay. Good morning, everyone, and good afternoon. It depends on how far you are from Brazil. It's a nice pleasure to have all you here with us. And for today, I'm pleased to present Dr. Diego Carnarolio that is here with us for presenting your seminar. Okay, before giving you the floor, Dr. Diego Carnarolio, please let me introduce you to our audience. Diego Carnarolio graduated in chemistry at the University of Turin, Italy, in 2011. Following that, Diego joined the Department of Drug Science and Technology, where he obtained his PhD degree in 2014 in Pharmaceutical and Biomolecular Sciences program. His main research interest was the application of microwaves and ultrasound energy source to improve chemical process. Diego then joined Milestone Company in Sorrisal, Italy in 2015, and today he is the Application and Business Development Manager. He is heading the application and the technical department to develop innovative solutions to drive the company towards new products to meet customers' needs. In 2017, he edited a book with Professor Giancarlo Cravotto titled Microwave Chemistry with the Gruyter publisher. In addition to the exposure during his PhD degree, Diego Carnarolio spent a couple of months here in Federal University of Santa Maria, thanks to a strong and fruitful collaboration between Professor Giancarlo Cravotto, his advisor in University of Turin, and Professor Erico Flores, who is advisor in our postgraduate program in chemistry. Today, Diego Carnarolio will present a webinar titled A Journey in Microwave Chemistry. In case of questions, I kindly ask you to use the chat in the YouTube channel during this live, and all the questions will be shared with the speaker at the end of the presentation. Dr. Diego Carnarolio, please. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Cesar. Thank you very much. Bon dia and good morning, everybody. I try to share the presentation now. Okay, great. So again, good morning. Good morning, everybody. I prepared this presentation and I titled it A Journey in Microwave Chemistry in order to provide you a quick overview of what we can do today with microwave. So you already know well that with microwave we can heat food for in our kitchen, but microwave can offer really much more if applied in the scientific field. When we talk about microwave, it's always nice to say a bit of history, and we can say that everything started during the Second World War in the 1945 when this guy, Dr. Spencer, basically he was working, you can imagine at that time he was working on communication, on the radar development, and the history told that during the experiment in the Spencer lab, this researcher noticed that having a chocolate bar in the pocket, the chocolate bar melted. He was a good observer, Dr. Spencer, and immediately recognized that the microwave that were going around in the laboratory that so it was not a good point, but in some way they were having a leakage in the equipment. But that microwave that was going around in the laboratory was capable to interact with the material, in that specific case with the chocolate bar, and to warm it up and at the end to melt it. Immediately, Spencer recognized the potential of this discovery. In the same year, basically, we are again in the 1945, Spencer patented the first construction of a microwave equipment, designed for heating heating food. We can recognize since that patent the most common components that are applied even today in all the microwave devices. So we have the magnetron, a waveguide, and then the cavity, the place where your kitchen you put the cap with the tea, the cap with the soup. So it was basically the same design of the construction we are still using today for building microwave equipment. Then we have to wait some years, a couple of years, and some companies, US companies, started to create the first trial of commercial microwave oven. It was not a success. It was really big, really heavy, and really expensive. So not ready for the diffusion to the mass, to the market as we are seeing today for microwave equipment. And that expansion, that commercialization started in the 70s, where when Japanese companies start to produce and to build a manufacturing line to produce low-cost microwave ovens. From that point, we have seen a really an exponential growth of the installation of microwave, both for domestic purpose, basically for heating food, and then starting from the 80s, more or less, we have seen a good increase in literature of the application of a microwave in different area of chemistry. But so apart the history, what is the real the real advantages and how microwave works when we apply to our food or to our chemical reaction. When we talk about microwave, we are talking about a specific range. Generally, is the range in between 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz. It's a pretty wide range, but we have to say at the same time that for scientific purpose and domestic purpose, we cannot use all of that frequency, because if we use that, we have the risk to interfere with the radio communication. For that reason, over the years, there were created the standard, the ISM frequencies, that, as reported in this table, are a list of frequencies that we can use for building microwave reactor, even for domestic, for industrial, and for scientific, and even medical application. Despite this long list, I would say that the frequency that have a larger diffusion are these two ones. So the 950 megahertz, mainly used for big industrial equipment, and the 2.45 gigahertz, which is, for example, the frequency that your microwave oven at home is working at that specific frequency. So we already mentioned about the range in the spectra that microwave are located, and now let's have a look to the energy involved in that part of the electromagnetic spectra. And the energy are not so high here. We are absolutely not able to promote directly chemical reaction, for example, to form bonds or to break bonds. So the energy is not enough in this part of the spectra, but we are able to have a good interaction of the electromagnetic wave with the material to promote molecular rotation. So at that energy, we are only able to have the molecules rotating based on the electric field that we apply on the material itself. So if you remember, in the 90s, there was a huge discussion in the mass media saying that microwave can damage food, can create cancer if you heat food with microwave. This is clearly absolutely wrong, because the energy involved in the microwave heating are not enough to degrade or to modify the structure of the material that we are heating. but we are able to promote molecular rotation, and then we see partially in this presentation to have nice advantages in their application in chemical reaction, in running synthesis, digestion, and all the field application where microwave are applied. So the two main effects we can have heating material with microwave are represented in this slide. So dipole rotation and ionic conduction. Dipole rotation is a typical example when you heat water. Water molecule has a clear dipole on the molecule. We apply an electric field, an alternative electric field, so we continuously change the direction of the electromagnetic wave we place in the cavity, and that rotation of the molecule that is aligned with the electric field of the electromagnetic wave, and that continuous change create an increase of energy of the molecule itself that it dissipates in form of heat. And from that specific effect, we have what is generally called direct heating or volumetric heating working with the microwave. This is the effect happening when we are heating material with dipoles, but we may have also another important effect, which is the ionic conduction, that it happens when you have free charge, for example, a salt diluted in water, you have free charge in the solution, and at that point, the same thing explained on the dipole rotation happened on the free charge, increasing the overall heat of the system. There are also other, I would say, side effect for chemistry generated by microwave with the material. So we do not have only these two effects, but talking about microwave chemistry, these are the two important, the two macro contribution of the microwave in the selective heating of our chemical mixture. This is the example of what I said just a few seconds ago. So dipole rotation for water and ionic conduction. When you have, for example, sodium chloride solution, you have free charge, and the ionic conduction contribution came from the salt, the free charge present in the solution itself. It is important when we run microwave chemistry to have more or less a prediction of what is the absorption, the capacity of the system that we are heating to interact with microwave and then to be heated up. And to understand this point, we can use this equation, the dielectric loss tangent, tan delta, basically, which is the contribution of the dielectric loss and the dielectric constant. Our constant value that depend to the kind of solvent or reagent that we are using, and they provide us a powerful information that we can see in this table. Basically, higher is the value of the tan delta, higher will be the interaction, the capacity of the system to interact with microwave. Basically, higher the tan delta, higher will be the heating rate of your system that will be microwave heated. And you see in this table that we can organize more or less in three main area: strong microabsorber, medium microabsorber, and low microabsorber. If you look in detail, we move from apolar, non-polar solvents, hexane, toluene, chlorinated solvent. They have a very poor interaction with microwave. Then we pass from medium absorber, water, DMF, moving to alcohol and glycol. They are so powerful microwave absorber. When we run microwave chemistry, we always need to have a look to that value in order to know if the system that I'm going to expose to the cavity to microwave heating is capable to heat it up properly or is not so a good microabsorber. And in this case, you can take your preliminary consideration in order how to how to design the experiment and what is the heating rate and the effect that you can expect on your chemical system. Then generally we never heat a clear and homogeneous solution. So generally we have reagents, we have solvents, we have catalysts. So it's always a mix of different ingredients to compose the chemical mixture. And just to give you an idea, reusing again the example of water and sodium chloride, let's have a look to the tan delta of water, pure water, where basically we only have dipole rotation. Let's see what happens when we add salt, free charge in water. The tan delta increased by 6 times. So depending to the contribution, depending on the characteristic of the reagent and solvent we are using, we can have dramatic effect in changing the capacity of the system itself to interact with microwave. Another consideration we can do is the comparison between water and ice. So if water, water molecules is free to rotate, so it can have a medium to good interaction with microwave. But if we block that interaction, that movement of the water molecules, and we go to ice, that there is no freedom for the molecules to rotate, you see that the tan delta decrease dramatically, so go nearly to zero. In fact, ice is a very poor microwave absorber, so we can compare ice to heptane as in terms of microwave absorption. But then you know that you can say, if I put a piece of ice in the microwave oven, I can easily heat it up. It is absolutely correct. This happened because on the ice surface, you always have a layer of water, and that layer of water on the surface target so much and so strong the microwave to that area, the energy, the temperature increase locally, and you start a cascade effect where the water on the surface is heated up very quickly, the ice melted, and then the overall capacity of the system to be heated increase a lot. So these are just small example in a very broad scenario that you can have in your chemistry to explain you the differences between working in conventional, that you do not have to take care about all these consideration because you put your flask on the heating plate, you heat it up without taking care. But when you work with microwave, you need to do this preliminary consideration, mainly when you work with unknown chemical mixture. Other advantages are huge because when you work with a conventional system, you always have a convention of heat creating a strong gradient of temperature inside your flask. When you work with microwave, you have a direct heating. So are the molecule itself that interact with microwave, converting form of heat, and you always have hotter temperature in the chemical mixture and lower temperature in the flask wall, which is exactly what we want. We want uniformity of temperature, no gradient inside the chemical mixture in order to have a very reproducible chemical reaction. And microwave can absolutely offer this point. So I show here some picture to say the same thing in a different way. For example, here is a drawing, a prediction of heating with a piece of butter. On the left with microwave, you see a hot temperature inside the butter and low temperature outside. When you heat the butter in conventional heating, you see hotter temperature outside and lower temperature inside. If you apply this to a chemical reactor, you always want to have the right temperature inside your chemical mixture and not clearly on the beaker or on the pressure reactor that you're using. And when we we produce chemical reactor, we basically take advantage from this point. We try to produce a reactor that are nearly transparent to microwave, and PTFE is a good material to be used for building a chemical reactor. And the microwave energy, the micro radiation, pass through the transparent reactor and reach the chemical mixture inside. And you see here, for example, the profile of a reactor with water inside, so the water is heated while the PTFE material, the wall of the reactor itself, remain cold. This is absolutely important and absolutely beneficial for the overall process. A quick look to the kind of construction we may have. So just a very quick overview to provide you a bit knowledge of what you have in your microwave equipment in your kitchen. We have three main components in all the reactors: the generator, the transmission line, and what is called the reactor or the applicator more in general. And if you look to the Spencer patent, as I mentioned at the beginning, we have the generator, which is generally the magnetron, the transmission line, which is generally the waveguide, this part, and the cavity, the applicator, which is the steel box where you put inside the cup, the pot to be heated up. Nearly all the equipment you can find in the market, both domestic and microwave reactor for laboratories, they use magnetron as a tool, as part to generate microwave. Magnetron is the one that you can see here in this slide, and it works in this way. So I use this slide to show you. Basically, inside microwave we have cathode and anode, which we apply a voltage, and this voltage generates electrons. The electrons will go in these holes that you can see here, and thanks to a magnetic field that is applied to this to the anode, the electrons start to rotate in all the holes, and they go in resonance and they create the microwave radiation. The microwave radiation at the end will be sampled by the antenna that you can see here, and then is transferred to the transmission line. To fix the concept, so you see this part of the magnetron, this is the terminal part of the antenna, and from this point all the microwave will came out from the magnetron itself. When we have sampled the microwave radiation, we move it through what I called before the waveguide, which is basically a rectangular tube on which the microwave start to be reflected till at the point that they arrive in the cavity. There are different type of cavity construction, and the most common are single mode and multi-mode construction type. Very briefly, I show you here the difference. So single mode is a kind of construction which enable to place a small reaction vessel directly in the waveguide. So you see here magnetron, waveguide, and reaction vessel, which is inside the waveguide. And with this construction, we can have a really high energy density of microwave in the point where we place the reactor. So the energy density is really high. So you can do very nice, you can run very nice chemical reaction, taking advantages to this high energy potential. But the limitation is that the waveguide are generally not too big, and this construction enabled to run milliliter scale reaction. If you want to run 40, 50, 60 milliliter, this construction is not fitting properly that need. But for small scale application, this is the best way to take advantage of the micro irradiation, because you have the reactor placed in the maximum point of the energy of the single mode construction. Multimode is something different, and multimode, for example, is are all the micro equipment you have in kitchen. And at the end of the waveguide, we have a big steel chamber, 50 liter, 70 liter chamber, where we have the microwave entering and going around through the reflection to the steel wall, and at the end heating up your reactor, your chemical mixture. This construction is less efficient in terms of energy transferred from the magnetron to the reactor, but because you have dissipation due to the reflection and the heating up of the cavity in some case, but it offers the capability to place inside a reactor of different shape, different function, so you have more flexibility in terms of tool and reaction scale that you can run in the microwave. A hybrid configuration is what we call in Milestone single reaction chamber technology that we invented and we patented, which is a hybrid configuration between multimode and single mode, where instead of having the reactor inside the waveguide, we have the reactor directly connected at the end of the waveguide, and the microwave, when generated, enter directly in contact with the solution without having reflection here and there as it happened in the conventional multimode cavity. This construction offers a compromise in terms of energy. It's not like the single mode, but it's even not like the multimode. It's something in between, and it enables to run a 1 liter scale reaction in a cavity with pretty much high energy density. To conclude about the multimode, as you can see here, is a domestic oven, and again, regarding the component, you have magnetron, you have a waveguide, and at the end you have your cavity where you put your pot to heat the food that you need. So domestic oven is a perfect representation of the multimode construction. Just a quick overview of the reactors you have. So we really started in the 70s with only domestic oven, that over the years different reactors, different tools were developed, and today we can really say that we do not have any limitation in terms of the tool, the reactors that you can use inside microwave. So nearly all the chemical reaction that you can run in conventional, you have the possibility and the right tool to be applied microwave to run properly. Reaction with gas, reaction with high pressure, with the reduced pressure, and so very, very nice flexibility. Just to show you some example of the main vessels, so they are mainly based in PTFE. Then you screw it to hold pressure. You have a possibility to run parallel reaction with 50-40 position, high pressure, or even there are solutions for medium pressure application where you have clearly more throughput because you have less component to be applied to hold the pressure. So huge flexibility in terms of the conventional multimode system, but even just to show you, for example, the single reaction chamber that I mentioned before, is a different workflow. You have a steel cavity where you can pressurize. This solution offers a possibility to run a reaction with gases, both reactive and inert. And this kind of reactor offers something alternative to the conventional microwave construction in the direction to facilitate and to enable the reaction with gases. I had a video, but we can skip to the second part, which is pretty much interesting related to application. We have seen in the first part a bit of history, a bit of basic concept on how the micro interact with the material, and a very fast overview of reactors and possibilities that we have today to run microwave chemistry in the professional equipments. Now let's have a look where the microwave were applied till today in microwave chemistry. The field of application are really different, and we have several fields of application, from elemental sample preparation, molecular sample preparation, synthesis, distillation, assisted micro-assisted distillation, ashing, and even a deep application in medical application that are not exactly in the field of chemistry, but I reported here because microwave are really used a lot in surgery and to do really precise work for the surgery. So it's important to report also that part, even is not directly related to chemistry. Just a quick overview of the elemental sample preparation. So we need to run sample preparation when we want to analyze the elements of the periodic table, because the techniques we have for the analysis, atomic absorption, ICP, require the elements in solution. They are not able to work with solid, but several times you need to analyze elements in solid, like pasta, like milk, like ore, like so very different material. To do that, you need to digest, and generally the digestion is performed with inorganic acids, boiling the acids with the heating plate. You create a very corrosive environment in the laboratory, but at the end, after several hours with the heating plate, you digest, you get all the elements in solution ready for the elemental analysis. Since the 70s, we were talking about domestic oven, not advanced and professional oven, was clear that applying microwave that have a very strong interaction with inorganic acids in terms of absorption was a plus, because the researchers saw that a typical digestion performing in hours, 1 hour, 2 hours, boiling the acids under the fume hood, apply microwave in 5-10 minutes, 50 minutes, the digestion was completed, and so was really, really fast. So it was impressive, the results achieved at that time, and in fact, today microwave are used a lot to digest sample for ICP analysis, but all kinds of sample, organic sample from agriculture's origin, clinicals, food, polymer, but even inorganic sample, ceramics, metals, ores, and so on. So with microwave and with the wet chemistry with acids, with the right combination of acids, you can digest all the sample you need to analyze elements. And for sure, you need to use the right combination of acids. The most common are nitric, chloridric, in some cases fluoridric acids. But with the right combination of acids, with the right reactor to use in microwave, you can digest even difficult samples like heavy oil, rock source, which are not so easy sample to get the solution. Some of these of these digestion, for example, when you digest an organic sample, you have your organic sample, you add your acids, and to digest it, you generate carbon dioxide to remove all the organic matrices. To do that, we run the reaction in a closed vessel in pressure, but at the end you generate pressure, and so the system, as we said before, must be transparent to microwave, because we do not want to have the reactor absorbing the microwave itself, but must be also capable to hold such huge pressure. For example, let's have a look in this graph. This is a typical temperature profile. What happened with a high reactive organic sample, boom, you have a bump of pressure. This is the pressure profile related also to a jump of temperature. And let's see here one of the duty of the use of microwave. So here you have a temperature profile that was following pretty much well the heating ramp, but at a certain point, the exothermal reaction happened, and in a few seconds, you had a strong jump of temperature. In this case, the microreactor immediately recognized these exothermal phenomena, stop the microemission, and immediately the system start to cool down without a delay in the stop of the irrigation of energy. And for this reason, again, in a few minutes, the reaction return to the set the heating profile and the reaction go ahead. If you want to replicate the same in a conventional way with a heating mantle or a heating plate, is impossible to have so fast control of exothermal process, because when you recognize it, you stop the heating plate to switch it off, but then you have a strong delay, a very low conventional heat that at the end will generate, will input energy, additional energy for the exothermal reaction. In the conventional way, a very difficult control at the end of the pressure itself. So microwave with the instant and very fast control of the on-off of the microwave can allow you to have a very nice control of the reaction. And this is an extreme case, but then in all the other cases, you can apply exactly the same benefits that we explained in this specific situation. So here, just to show you that at the end, the target is to have a clear solution, because, for example, when you digest organic sample, means you have as target to have a low carbon content solution, because, you know, carbon can create polyatomic interferences in the analysis. And so good digestion, good control of the temperature is an important point when we run digestion with microwave for sample preparation for ICP. And here I reported just some of the polyatomic spectral interferences that you can have if the digestion is not good. You have residue inside, so you can really have at the end false analysis and wrong understanding of the spectra that you are measuring. That part was related to the wet chemistry, with inorganic acid. But same time, we also need to analyze metal, to analyze residue, to heat it up the system to a very high temperature. And I mentioned at the beginning that most of the reactors are made of PTFE. If we want to do ashing generally takes place at 600, 800, 1000 degrees C in muffle. So that with that kind of configuration is impossible. But thanks to the development, is today possible also to run microwave ashing, thanks to some specific equipment where PTFE is not present in the cavity. We have a solution with refractory material, where you can have a really fast heating rate, good insulation, and you can run hashing or sintering, depending on the application, at very high temperature, 1,200 degrees C. With the important point compared to conventional muffle, with an amazing heating rate. So with a microwave muffle, you can easily reach 1,200 degrees C in 10, 15 minutes, depending to the final temperature. So the heating rate is so fast and uncomparable to conventional muffles. So I show you this example of the muffles, the microwave muffles, to prove you and to show you that really We have today available several different solutions, different tools to be applied in the cavity to run reaction at different pressure condition and temperature. And that case was a good example to show you high temperature application. In this part, I want to touch the, because it's not only digestion, it's also extraction when you talk about microwave. And here the case of the molecular sample preparation. So we mentioned before for digestion, the digestion of heating plate with acid in the beaker. When you talk about a little bit milder application, solvent extraction, we have as reference the SOXLET. SOXLET, you know, is a very old apparatus. It works lovely, but it's time consuming and it uses a lot of solvent. So it's not, we can say, really a green approach to extract target analyze. Microwave with all the tool I mentioned before, it offers a good alternative to do solvent extraction working on pressure and temperature. So with the pressure reactor designed for microwave, you can heat it up easily, the solvent mixture, the extraction mixture, increasing pressure and temperature. These provide a nice advantages because increasing pressure and temperature of the system, you at the end increase the solubility of the analyte in the solvent, but you also decrease the viscosity of the solvent itself, having an easier and better penetration on the solvent in the matrix. For example, this is a common example we use. Anthracene is 15 times more soluble in dichloromethane if you work at 150 degrees C compared to 50 degrees C. So easy to say, but then if you think about how to heat it up dichloromethane at 150, it's not so easy. You need to have the right hardware, the right pressure reactor, and with microwave you need to balance properly the absorption depending to the extraction mixture you are heating. But as I mentioned today, depending on the reactor, on the tool, even such kind of application is possible without strong limitation. In the field of solvent extraction, I report to you only this case, which is the total fat extraction. You know, total fat is a typical value reported in all the foods that you, nearly all the foods that you can purchase at the grocery. And total fat is a labor and time intensive application because it's performed in two steps generally. First step, hydrolysis to get the fat free from the matrices. And then the second part is the SOXLET extraction to extract the fat from the material itself. Generally, the entire application takes a full day, or better, we can say it takes 2 days to be completed. With microwave, we can combine hydrolysis and extraction in the same step. And we can do that lovely because we take advantage of the selective heating of microwave. So if we imagine to combine, for example, milk powder with acidic solution, for example, sulfuric solution, water sulfuric solution, and cyclohexane, you have at the end a very heterogeneous mixture. It's very heterogeneous. You need to mix it well, but then you need to heat it well, because if you do not do that, at the end, the reproducibility of the data you get at the end is very poor. Microwave enable this nice thing. So when you have this system with water, acidic water solution and cyclohexane is nearly transparent to microwave. So when you heat this system, you are basically focusing the energy in the water part, the acidic water part, where take place the hydrolysis. And the hydrolysis is, in this application, the most demanding, the most critical step of the entire determination. And thanks to this focus on microwave in the place where require more energy, we are able to run the entire process, the entire total fed determination in a single step with maintaining very high reproducibility of the data. And this is just an example. Starting from that, you can really think about several cases, for example, in organic synthesis or in another kind of extraction, when you need to get to have the hydrolysis step and then extraction, you can combine it together and you can really speed up the overall analytical workflow of your analysis. But as I mentioned before, you always have to have a look to the different capacity of the component in the system to interact with microwave. And here, the case I reported, we have seen good microabsorber, the sulfuric water solution, and a poor microabsorber, the cyclohexane, which in this case enable us to set a nice experimental design to focus microwave in the specific place where we need it. So then we have some data just to show you the accuracy. So this graph easier show. So we run different kind of food stuff, but then the accuracy of the fat analyzed with microwave was really overlapping the value or the reference value of all the material. So the accuracy was really really good. Clearly, it's not only this. I just used this example to describe a specific case, but then you can apply microwave for extracting pesticides, contaminants from soil, to extract BH, dioxin. So really a wide class of target analytes extractable from different sources, both from food, from vegetal, and from environmental samples. Always in the field of, I would say, extraction, but a little bit different, there is a nice example of application of microwave for not analytical application, but a kind of a processing application. And the case I show you here in this part of the presentation is related to the natural product extraction. You know, from botanical we can extract a lot of molecules, and mainly generally the main targets we have seen are volatile compounds like myrcene, limonene, so-called generally terpenes or essential oil, and heavy molecules like antioxidants, flavonoids, polyphenols, and so on. We have seen that, so I skip this part, probably I return back later, but we have seen that working in this area with botanical, in particular fresh botanical, and apply microwave, we can have a really nice effect, because microwave go to interact with the in-situ water that you have, for example, in your basil, in your lavender, in your flower that you want to distill and to get the essential oil. And locally, you create a fast increase of temperature with a fast release of the target analytes. So this localized heating generated by the direct heating we explained before generate at the end a very fast process. And based on this effect, in Maestro we patented years ago the construction of what we call micro-assisted distillation equipment. It's basically, let me say, an hydro distillation performed in microwave. So you have your reactor where you put your botanical, and then outside of the microwave cavity, we can have a condenser where we collect the essential oil. So we can have also other configuration for extracting heavier compound than essential oil, as I mentioned before, polyphenols and so on. But I want to show you a specific case related, for example, to the citrus or essential oil extraction. We can extract essential oil from citrus from different using different technologies. The two main uses are mechanical pressing, so cold pressing, or something similar to what I explained with micro, the steam distillation, the conventional steam distillation. Let's have a look to the differences. So with microwave, we can get a good extraction in 15 minutes, with hydrodistillation in 3 hours, and in cold pressing, basically 1 hour. So cold pressing, if you want, is ideal because you get essential oil without too much thermal degradation, because basically you are not heating up the system. But the problem of the cold pressing is that despite the nice quality of the essential oil, the yield is very poor. If you want to get a good yield of oil, you need to heat it up the system. And the conventional approach is offered by the steam distillation, the hydrodistillation, that get good yield, but longer processing time. And at the end, that exposure of the botanical to hours at 100 degrees C, it results in the oil with odor of boiled. So you really smell the boiled odor from the final product. Microwave offer the capability to get comparable yield if you compare to the steam distillation, but with a significant reduction of time. So from 3 hours, we run the same extraction in 15 minutes. And at the end, the oil that you can obtain with microwave is matchable with the quality of the oil obtained with the cold pressing. Thanks to the really short processing time, and thanks to the fact and the localized heating that the microwave works on the water, the in-situ water present in the fresh botanical. And so if you look to the chromatogram, then we prove that seeing that we microwave, the number of the oxidized terpenes are significantly less compared to the conventional approach. I just report this case additionally to this application because it's something that is a market, an application that is growing a lot in the US recently, which is the cannabis extraction. In that field, microwave found a very nice application because in to get cannabinoids extract for medicinal and recreational purpose, you need to extract it with solvent or ethanol or pressurized hydrocarbon or supercritical CO2, but basically you need to apply solvent. And depending to the techniques that you apply, in some cases the techniques require dry material, and when you are drying the material, you are losing basically the volatile, or you apply solvent on which, for example, ethanol, it became impossible then to collect the terpene and to have a good scent of the material itself. So microwave in the overall cannabis processing found a nice application thanks to the fast process that they require to extract the essential oil. They can work directly on fresh material, so you get the fresh scent of the material itself that then proceed to additional drying and additional processing to get the heavy compound, the high boiling compound, which are generally the cannabinoids CAC and CBD. And at the end, the manufacturer can rebuild together the active part, the which are the cannabinoids, to the flavoring, the scent part, which provide good taste and good scent to the final product, which is always good for the market and for the consumer. And again, the pivotal point for this processing design was the speed that the microwave can offer in the distillation of oils from fresh material. And so here again, also some data about the terpenes. So you see here with micro, you can extract a lot of different terpenes which are depending to the origin and to the type of the raw material, and you can lovely extract it with the micro application. I show you some slides before small equipment, but micro is not only a small application. You can run medium size extraction, but even industrial extraction. In this case, I show here in this slide a device we have in portfolio called ETOS-XL, which is a semi-industrial equipment, automatized equipment, which allows to run more or less 10-15 kilogram of material in an hour of process, which at the end of the day is a scale of interest for processing environment. So the scale is important, and it offers really at the end essential oil in an amount that you can use for building consumers' products. So I show you this to I did not touch this part, but remember that despite all the laboratory equipment I show in this talk, you can find in literature, and you can find a lot of example of success of application of microwave in industrial scale. To conclude, so I leave it at the end, and I will go quickly on this, but it's the part where so my background started, which is organic synthesis. So microwave, starting from the 90s, found a very strong application, 90s and the beginning starting from the 90s, basically you find a huge increase of publication regarding organic and as well as inorganic synthesis. So they were applied in all, nearly in all kind of reaction, proving a lot of benefits in terms of efficiency, selectivity of the heating, less production of wastes. So you can really run synthesis in a much more efficient and reproducible way running with microwave. And in this side, I do not want to enter in detail because then it's very broad area of application. But I want to focus, if you are an organic chemist, to the way that you have to heat your chemical reaction. So if you look back, really back, you can heat your round bottom flask with the Bunsen, but it is inefficient, not safe way to provide energy to your chemical system. For that reason, if you want to have something more safer and more uniform in terms of heating distribution, you generally use a heating plate, or better, a heating mantle. But as I explained at the beginning, you always have convection of heat from the mantle to the flask itself. As I discussed at the beginning, in the 70s started the commercialization of the domestic oven, micro domestic oven, and in the 90s basically the main application you can find with micro were based on domestic oven. So several researchers purchase oven from the supermarket and use it to run chemical synthesis, and you find really nice pioneering works working with such devices. But then in domestic oven you do not have a pressure reactor, you do not have flexibility in terms of the tools that you can use, And additionally, you do not have real control of the microwave, you do not have control of temperature, and then you affect so much the reproducibility of your experiments. That's why a professional micro equipment is important to run experiment in at first safe condition, but also with a nice and precise control of temperature, pressure, and so all the parameters that at the end allow you to write a methodology, a protocol, which is which you have good chance to be reproduced. Several equipments designed from Milestone and also from other vendors, they were good for flexibility in terms of volume, in terms of pressure capability, but there was a big hole over the years regarding the possibility to run microwave chemistry with gases. And in fact, if you look to the years back, it was difficult to find application with microwave, for example, for hydrogenation, carboxylation, oxidation. So it was not easy because there was a lack of equipment capable to doing that application in a good way. And a common tool is a conventional autoclave, a PAR reactor, for example, to run hydrogenation. Today, with the possibility to have this new kind of reactor, as I described before, very briefly, the single reaction chamber reactor, we are capable to run reaction with gases without limitation. So really today, with microwave we add the last piece of the cake, adding the gas capability to the reactor to load hydrogen, carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, oxygen. So these are the most common reactive gases we can apply in microwave chemistry. And with single reaction chamber is really possible to run in a safe way and in a controlled way all this chemistry. And here I just to show you a quick overview of an example of application of microwave gases, for example, with carbon dioxide, for example, to run Staudinger-Hazewittig reaction with the insertion of carbon dioxide. We can run with oxygen, with oxidative atmosphere catalyzed with palladium on charcoal. Carbon monoxide as well is possible, of course. Then you need to do all the safety in using carbon monoxide because it's very toxic, but you can run carboxylation very, very lovely with microwave. Hydrogenation is one of the most used reaction in organic synthesis, and with this kind of tool is possible. And then I show you this last paper that I personally published during my PhD, where I was able to run in the field of the biomass conversion a really complete process with microwave, starting to decompose a lignocellulosic material with a specific microreactor to create building blocks, and then with another equipment to rebuild that building blocks in biopolymer. So I show this example at the end just to say, not specific of the chemistry, but to say that if you want to design a process, in this case of a kind of synthesis or decomposition and then synthesis, you have today reactors that offer you capability and flexibility to run really different reaction, different things to approach properly a process from the beginning till the final compounds that you have interest to synthesize. So of course, in this way, I forced a little bit the concept, and not always microwave is needed. It depends to the specific case, the specific reaction you have to perform. But when you select and you identify advantages, possible advantages in applying micro in your chemistry, today you can easily do that because you have all the tools ready to be applied for different type of chemistry. Well, to conclude, if you have interest to have a bit more information, I would suggest some reading. I personally, together with my professor, PhD, Professor Cravotto, we edited this book published by De Gruyter, titled Micro in Chemistry, which really in all the chapter touch different areas of application of the microwave in the recent history. It's nice reading and is a good collection of all the researches. Then if you have interest a bit more in the processing part for the natural product destruction, I would suggest this book, which is really nice. There are a lot of examples and a very clear explanation about the application of microwave for the destruction of bioactive compounds, both essential oil compound and antioxidants in general. It's a really nice book describing example in a lab scale, but not only. You can find good example also for the industrial scale application. So my presentation is finished. I hope you enjoy that kind of journey in the microwave chemistry, and I leave to you, Cesar, the word if there are any question, any curiosity on this specific topic.
Okay, thank you very much, Diego. It is again a pleasure to have you here, in this time not presentially but virtually, and your talk was very, very clear, and I think the people that really have interest to use this technology becomes more confident, and I think it's very important. The questions are arriving in the chat, but I, as the person who is in the middle way between you and the live transmission, I give me the right to do the very first one, because this subject is very interesting for me, and I do appreciate this kind of subject. Okay, Diego, it's not really a question. I just will present an aspect, and I want to see your opinion about that.
Yeah.
Considering all the advantages, all the advances related to the microwave evolution from the beginning up to now, it's possible to assume that the microwave heating practically changes the way as chemistry is performed. There is another technologies. There are other technologies associated to this, but the chemistry we perform today is a bit different. And microwaves has an important role associated to this. In your opinion, the main aspect associated to this change promoted in chemistry are related or is related to the very fast heating promoted by microwaves, or the way as microwave interact with sample, which change a little bit the profile of heating, or it is more related to the technologies related to microwaves. For example, sensors of temperature and pressure and how to manage with these parameters, controllers, basically. If you can expand a little bit, I do appreciate it.
Yes, absolutely. I think it is a combination of both the factors you mentioned, because since the origin microwave offer nice advantages, specific advantages that at the end enable to run reaction faster compared to the conventional approaches. So if you run the reaction in a shorter time, thanks to a more homogeneous meeting, thanks to some specific effect that you have with microwave, at the end you can be more productive and you can proceed much faster in the research if you're running research, or in analysis if you are a laboratory that need to analyze sample. And so these this way to speed it up, the chemical reaction, was an important point for integrating today microwave in several laboratories. There was a huge discussion about thermal effect, non-thermal effect. I want to say that even today it's not so clear if microwave are really capable to provide non-thermal effect to the chemical reaction. There are some clear examples in literature, depending to the reaction mechanism, where microwave can where very well explained that interact deeply in the mechanism itself. But in several other cases, I think is purely the advantages came purely from the efficiency of the heating you have, because you can work with the heating mantle that in the laboratory is the apart microwave is the most efficient way, uniform way you have to heat up the chemical mixture. But at the end, you never have good distribution, good temperature uniformity in the flask. And temperature in nearly all the chemical reactions that they require energy is an extremely important parameter. So a lot of the reproducibility depend to the capacity to control the temperature in the chemical process. Microwave, as we have seen in the presentation, interact directly with the molecules, and the molecules itself generate the heat. You can heat or stop to heat the solution in a fraction of second. You do not have any delay, and starting from that point, really a nice portfolio of reactor, of sensors, of technology was developed to work around this specific concept in order to provide the chemist a tool capable to nicely control all the reaction parameter. And I think that controlling properly the parameter of the reaction you're running is a point of extreme value. And I think that is one of the reason why, not the only one, but from my point of view, is the main why microwaves are so applied in the laboratory. And then also thanks to specific application like the wet chemistry to digest sample, the advancement in the design of the reactor was huge. So today, if you want to run a reaction in pressure, is not easy to find conventional flexibility in conventional heating. So it is so easy to buy a pressure reactor, a microwave pressure reactor, and to run the reaction in microwave for that reason, because they are easier to find and to implement in the laboratory itself. So also thanks to specific applications, so the development was so important, and today we have nice hardware that enable to take advantage to basically to the microwave chemistry.
Okay, thank you, Diego. Okay, I have some questions here. Let me share with you. The very first one is from Diana Kaminsky, and I try to translate it. She asked two questions. I will present you both at the same time. Using the system used example for extracting PCBs and PCHs from soil samples. Do you remember, Diego, the system?
Yes.
Okay. Would it be possible, feasible to extract it, the contaminants from an absorbent? And she asked about considering, for you considering, passive atmospheric sample. And the other question is about since it's frequently used extraction methods requiring high solvent consumption, is it possible to reduce this consumption using microwaves? And the first question is about PCBs and PAHs and extractions from adsorbents, atmospheric sample. And the second one is about to reduce the solvent consumption using microwaves for extraction approach.
I start from the first question. During the presentation, I briefly mentioned the extraction of polychlorobiphenyl, polyaromatic hydrocarbon from environmental sample. Basically, I mentioned about soils, sledges, and that kind of sample. But there is absolutely no limitation. You can extract the same target analytes from atmospheric sample, from filter, when you trap the molecules on the filter, and then you extract from that filter the target analytes. There is no limitation. This is the analytes you can easily treat with microwave. Of course, you need to use the proper solvent system that has a good affinity to the target analytes itself, but then the microwave can work really well also to different kind of matrices in the solvent extraction. So I touch more on the digestion to show you all the kind of matrices that you can treat, but you can imagine exactly the same range, the same wide range of sample, even for solvent extraction on contaminants. There is absolutely no limitation on that. And so I connect here to the second question. The solvent consumption is an important point, because I report an example of the SOxLator. Even so, another technique you can use is the sonication to extract target analytes. So to put in a beaker your, for example, your filter with the analytes trapped inside, and then to sonicate for an hour. But you always need a hundredth milliliter of solvent, because you're not heating up too much, because the solvent that you use generally are organic solvent with pretty much low boiling point. You cannot heat it up too much, and you need to put a huge quantity, a strong dilution to facilitate the extraction itself. In microwave, you saw all the pressure reactor part of the pressure reactor available. You can put your filter, your soil, your food in the reactor. Then you add, generally, a typical solvent extraction is 10-15 milliliter of solvent, and then you heat it up above the boiling point of the solvent itself, and you speed it up the process a lot. I mentioned 10-15 milliliter. You know that when you work with SOxLator or you work with ultrasonic application, it's not a volume that generally is applied there. Generally use at least 100 milliliter to have an efficient extraction. 100 milliliter, which is a cost, a problem to deal all this solvent, but then in the workup you always have to evaporate it. So the advantages is not only specific to the time of the extraction of the reaction, but also to all the workups you can have after the specific extraction or the specific reaction. And solvent consumption reduction is an important advantage working with pressure reactor in microwave.
Okay, thank you, Diego. And Diana, sorry if my translation didn't represent precisely your question. I tried to do my best. Okay, let's go to the next one. Diego, the next question was performed by Vittoria Calduro. And great presentation, Diego. Can you comment on the challenge of scaling up microwave processes?
Good question. The challenge is important. It's not easy to do scaling up. In the presentation, I show you the part where we talk about generator, transmission line, and an applicator. Then I follow up that concept in the direction to laboratory equipment. So that kind of construction you have seen, single mode, multi-mode, are specific construction for, I would say, very small scale reactor or to medium scale reactor. Medium scale, I mean to arrive to 70 liter cavity, 100 liter cavity, but no more. Going to a larger scale require an important change in the design of the equipment itself, and in several cases also to a change in the frequency of the microwave that you are using. Why? Because all the equipments I show in this presentation were equipments working at 2.45 gigahertz. At that frequency, the penetration depth of the microwave in a material is a few centimeters, is very limited. The energy is completely absorbed in a few centimeters of material. If you imagine a ton scale reactor, this is an important limitation. That's why if you want to design industrial scale reactor, you need at first to change the frequency that you apply to the system, and 915 megahertz is a good frequency where the penetration depth is higher, but at that point it changes in an important way the construction itself of the reactor. So to reply in an easier way, it's possible to do the scaling up, but generally the step is to select and to design the process in a small scale working at 2.45 gigahertz. And after that, when you identify the reaction, you identify the parameters, to really do an engineering work to design the reactor around the specific reaction, the specific application you have to run. There are several examples of industrial application. For example, from the biodiesel production, there are several industrial plants running that. We do not know, but nearly all the food companies that have to dry material use microwave. So nearly all the industrial drying are performed with microwave because it's an efficient approach to run drying. And so there are several examples, but of course there are challenges related to penetration depth and reactor construction.
Very nice, Diego. Thank you very much. I have the same opinion. Thinking about scaling up is a matter of your needs. If you need frequency or if you need big size.
Yeah.
Very nice, very nice. Thank you very much. Let's move to the next one. The next one was performed by Professor Sider Santos. Thank you for your wonderful lecture, Dr. Carnarolio. Do you have any application of microwave-assisted synthesis of nanomaterials such as graphene, carbon nanotubes, or even quantum dots? This is your field, I think.
Yeah, not my specific, but the group where I worked was and is very active on that research. Yes, absolutely. If you search in literature with the keywords microwave, nanotubes, microwave outdoors and so on, you can find a lot because graphene and all the carbon-based material, graphene-based material has a so powerful interaction with microwave. They are a strong microwave absorber, and modifying the surface of the carbon nanotubes is so much improved applying microwave heating, because you increase really high the energy on the surface on the carbon nanotubes, make it much faster and much easier the interaction with the surface itself. So you are on the field, you know how difficult it is to do the first link of organic molecule to the surface of the nanotube. So the chemistry to do that is not so I would say so mild. It's a very aggressive chemistry, and with micro you can simplify a lot the chemical system to do that application. If you search in literature, you can find a lot of good example of micro in that field.
Thank you again, Diego. Yes, it's challenging because we have some experiences here in our lab considering the graphite heating and carbon nanotubes, and it's really aggressive. It's not only a matter of using the conventional reactors and try to obtain very under controlling process or target analytes. It's a very challenging. Of course, we use it for sample preparation, our field of expertise, but it's a very nice, very interesting point. Let's move to the next one, which was performed by Professor Erico Flores. Congratulations by the webinar. How do you see the trends or challenges in sample preparation using microwaves in terms of instrumentation?
Well, we have done a lot, not only Maestro, but generally the companies involved in the business of sample preparation done a lot over the years. And the single reaction chamber technology is, I think, the top of the evolution of the reactors designed to run sample preparation, because the introduction of that technology simplified a lot the workflow. It's changed completely the working range of the reaction, because with that technology you can go at a higher temperature, higher pressure, and so you can run chemical processes that before was difficult due to technical limitation of the equipment. That was a nice introduction, and we can do much more, and much more is going to work on the way we have to generate the microwave. So I mentioned during the talk the use of magnetron, but there are also other technologies to offer much more efficiency, much more focusing of the micro and the material, that at the end will enable in an efficient application of micro, transferring of the micro energy to the solution itself. So a huge work has to be done in that direction in the micro generation. And and also I think in a kind of automation and simplification of the workflow of the process itself to prepare reactor and to run at the end the reaction. So there is a lot to do, and why not also a bit door open to evaluate combined way to heat up the solution in order to take selectively the advantage in the specific part of the heating ramp or the heating step that you want to run. Yeah, there are several things that to be exploited.
Thank you, Diego. Thank you again. Yes, I believe we have already talked about this aspect some years ago in a conference, maybe, and because while the sample heating, while the temperature increase, the dielectric properties of the sample starts changing. Then the penetration depth also changes, and in summary, we lost energy. And it's a very nice approach, considering that the generator would change, and perhaps the frequency also changes.
Yeah, one of the technology that is really promising is the solid state generator, so rather than the magnetron. The problem of that technology as of today is the cost and the limited capacity in terms of power that they have to deliver, but the potential of the solid state generator is huge, because you can work with a single generator at different frequency. You can tune properly, and you can heat selectively one area or one place of your cavity. So it will change completely the way to construct the reactor. A lot of advancement are in the pot in these years. I see nice evolution of that technology, but as of today, it's still early to see a solid state in a large diffusion, in a large application on chemical reactor. But sooner or later, I hope very soon, we will enter in the construction of the micro equipment, and at that point you'll see really nice thing, different thing in the way to work with micro. It opened the door to really nice application.
Sounds good. Sounds really good. Let's move to, at least to now, the last question. It was performed by Gustavo Kilk. And I remember that I spent some time in Italy some years ago, and I had the opportunity to visit Milestone Company and discuss a little bit with you about the possibility of use ultrasound or developed some ultrasound systems. And the question of Gustavo goes exactly in the same direction. Let's see if the answer changed or not. Okay, does the company think about developing equipment that combine alternative energies such as microwave and ultrasound?
That's one of the points I mentioned briefly, to combine different technology, different heating sources, or in this case, to combine a nice way to heat the material and a nice way to mix the material with the ultrasound. This for sure is one of the possibility. We already have some solution to run this kind of combination. The step, the point we have to work to that is to integrate and to have a good control of both the solution, both the micro and both the ultrasound, which is not an easy task, because when you apply both at a certain point are hit the chemical reaction, and so at that point the control, the fine control of both the way to work on the chemical mixture is really fundamental. We already have today in our offer possibility to combine a multi-mode micro reactor with an ultrasound device, a horn that then cannot be a standard horn, because generally made in titanium. You cannot put a titanium in micro, you don't start to discharge with the arc. They are made in pyrex, in quartz, so not so easy construction, but we have today in portfolio this kind of solution that are really nice, because you can combine two technology, microwave to have a fine control of the heating, and ultrasound, which offer a fine mixture of the reagent together that are really nice. I work a lot with ultrasound, and I love that technology to increase the mixing of solid in the liquid, and it's very nice.
Yes, Diego, thank you. And the expertise of Professor Giancarlo Cravotto in this field is amazing.
Yeah.
He has a lot of possibilities of both ultrasound, microwave, or their combination in the same system in the lab. And it's very, very interesting and very important. Okay, Diego, there is no additional questions in the chat. I think people really enjoyed your presentation because normally in English, the questions becomes a little bit more shy, you know, they avoid to ask, but people really did it. And thank you very much. Let me thank you again for your availability, for your time. In Italy is the end of the expedient, I think. You must go home now.
Yeah, now, yes.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a very nice moment that we share with us, and the information you bring us is really important. Thank you very much. Considering yourself invited to be here with us as soon as possible, presentially, due to the pandemic moment, it's not possible, but I think we can overcome this situation quite soon.
Yeah.
Thank you again, and hope to see you soon.
Thank you, Cesar. Thank you, everybody, for your attention. Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. See you.
Bye.